have kindly offered to host us as our usual location has been flooded. So we're very grateful we're all for hosting us here today. Introduction, so I'm Emily Spurrell, I'm the Merseyside Police and Crime Commissioner.
James Leyshon, I'm head of private office in the OBCC.
Good afternoon, I'm the Ryan, head of preventative policing for Merseyside Police.
Good afternoon, I'm Paul White, temporary assistant chief constable, responsible for response and resolution in the Metro.
Hello, I'm Helen Stafford, head of finance, representing Keith Dickinson, director of resources.
Good afternoon, assistant chief constable John Roy, responsible for local policing, criminal justice and preventative policing.
Good afternoon, Ian Critchley, Deputy Chief Constable.
Serena Kennedy, Chief Constable.
Louise Kane, Head of Performance and Analytics.
John Murray, Chief Finance Officer for the Police Department.
Okay, thank you very much. We've got apologies for absence from Keith, but obviously we've got Helen in his stead, and we've got apologies from Chris Reed as well. Are there any other apologies that we need to record?
The Jenny Sims.
Okay, great. Moving on then to minutes of the last meeting and also the action tracker. Is everybody happy that the minutes are an accurate record? Want to find the accuracies? No? Okay, good. In terms of the actions, I think there's just two, I think, are outstanding. One around the outcome of the DA intensification period. Not sure if we've had that information yet.
Commissioner, yes, so I've checked with that today. We're just trying to see who an investigation has actually done the briefing because we haven't tested it out. We'll get over to you later, either later today or tomorrow.
Okay, perfect. And then the second one was around the outliers for non-emergency calls. I don't think we've had that information yet either.
Right, okay, I'll send that on an email then because we've got that.
That'd be great.
I could do, I'll take that, but if you want to put that and send it over.
That'd be great, yeah, thank you.
Commissioner, I could give you that based on the performance around non-emergency calls last year compared to this year, but without, I think that was the discussion we had at the last meeting.
Yeah, I think it was the question from John in terms of the kind of the end of the spectrum, so what was the longest that people were waiting, if you have that information, that'd be useful.
Well, I don't have the longest period. I can give you, in terms of a brief overview of where we are in terms of performance to date, etc. I mean, we are, end of last year, we were 74.9% for the non-emergency calls. That was against 81.8% the year before, but clearly the ability to compare performance during sort of low COVID period and coming out of COVID is obviously somewhat different. But if I put it into some context, the year before, 1920, the SLA was 25.1%, so you would see significant improvements on that previous year. The average time to answer the non-emergency line were increased from 51.7 seconds this year compared to 34.7 last year, but in 2019-20 it was 4 minutes and 28 seconds, so you can see significant improvements there. And the abandoned rate on the 101 line increased to 7.5% from 3.45% last year, but it was 25.1% in 2019-20. So I think that would demonstrate considerable improvements in performance. And we do compare very favourably with other forces, particularly metropolitan forces, albeit as you're aware, we haven't not in the beating time plan, we've gone to the 101 performance yet, it's only 9 at this point.
Yeah, no, thank you, that's very positive picture to all work. Okay, great. Anything else on the minutes or actions? Maybe not to freeze. No? Okay, thank you for that. Right, we're going to move on now then. So obviously today's theme is all about early intervention and prevention and how we divert people away from the criminal justice system and what the police role is within that. So I'm very pleased that we've got Andy Ryan to talk to us today about the force approach to preventative policing.
Thank you, Commissioner. Good afternoon to all. And thanks for the opportunity to come along and speak to you about our approach to preventative policing and what we've got in place to enhance our strategy with regard to preventative policing. So, I'm going to talk, if I may, around our objectives, why these are important. I'll touch upon a case study that supports the rationale as to why we believe the work that we're pushing on with is necessary. Our strategy and how we'll deliver this for our communities, the approach and steps that we'll take to effectively deliver a more preventative policing service to Merseyside. An example of some of the preventative work that's being led by our Operation Interface team at this moment in time. Before finishing on, I suppose what will start to look and feel different as we move towards a more preventative approach.
whilst I want to talk about the recent work that we've been doing to enhance our approach to preventative, I think it's really important that I start by recognising that there's already lots of excellent work going on around prevention in Merseyside Police at the moment, whether it be local policing officers, CSOs, our R&R officers, road policing and so on. There's some outstanding examples of preventative work. And it's also important to point out that many of our partners are doing the same, so there's some really good preventative work out there. But we'll all no doubt accept that there are opportunities for us to be more preventative in our approach, in how we go about our daily business, and how we can work better together to prevent the reoccurrence of certain incidents and issues that are occurring in our communities. And so, you know, it's our intention that we work more collaboratively in future. By having a more preventative mindset, we'll be more effective in reducing and preventing crime and ASB. You know, this is why the Chief Constable highlights preventative policing as a force priority from the outset, and we're now gathering some real momentum within the force, and you know, real passion for prevention as we move forward. And of course, recognise that preventing offending is a key pillar featuring heavily within your police and crime plan also, and so it's a real key priority here in Merseyside, that's really good for us in terms of pushing on with that momentum. We're now working hard to deliver against the ambitions that have been set for us by the Chief Constable, and you know, we're not there yet, but there's lots and lots of work being done to embed this preventative approach across Merseyside Police, and you know, we hope that this will pay dividends in future years. As we, I suppose, push on, as our preference and undoubtedly our focus is to prevent crime rather than deal with its aftermath. On the screen there we have some of our objectives. For a number of months now we've had a team working on designing and implementing a renewed approach to preventative, which I know you're aware of, Commissioner. It's been a really valuable exercise in understanding our strengths and where there are opportunities for us to further develop our approach. All this work, the consultation, the benchmarking and the learning that we've taken from this has helped us to identify a number of objectives, some of which are on the screen. One objective will be the elimination of opportunities to commit crime, so by designing out crime through more traditional crime prevention initiatives, as it were, or through target hardening and the problem solving of issues within our communities. Utilising more preventative approaches to how we police, taking the learning from what works and, importantly, what hasn't worked as well, and considering how and when we deploy our resources, and I'll come on to a little bit more about that in a few minutes if I may. We're looking for assistance opportunities through interventions aimed at reducing re-offending, so restorative justice and other alternative mechanisms to the criminal justice system, particularly young people. Enhanced engagement with our communities, and notably with our young people, is vital in our approach to effective prevention, and so you'll see a renewed provision from our safer schools officers, and how we'll engage children and young people to enhance our legitimacy with this really important group and cohort for us. The identification and response to adverse childhood experiences, so through delivery of education and training to our workforce, through, for instance, trauma-informed training, will better equip us rather to identify those early signs of childhood trauma, thus enabling us to effectively respond, or, as is often the case, identify the need to engage appropriate partners and maybe better equipped to provide the right response in support of those with more complex needs. Really importantly is the need to work collaboratively with our partners. You know, we recognise that whilst we're making progress, we can't make progress on the scale of our ambition without working with our key partners and stakeholders. So partners in local authorities, health, fire, housing, probation and many more have skills, powers, data and other assets that we don't have, and so by pooling these resources, by sharing our data more effectively and working better together, we have a much better chance of preventing offending behaviour, supporting vulnerable people, reducing antisocial behaviour and achieving our ambitions. So what's important for me to point out there is, you know, preventative policing isn't seeking to push us into a space where we fix problems that some might say are not ours to fix, or to deliver interventions that partners are better qualified to address. Instead, our aim is to consistently be part of a whole system approach to prevention, working in collaboration with partners and communities. And this will allow us to identify any crossover, duplication, opportunities for improved working practices to design a whole system to reduce demand across agencies and provide the right support for those who need it most. This is just a case study to illustrate why a more preventative approach is required.
There are many cases we could use to support this point, but in this case, which is clearly being anonymised, it shows the vulnerability that exists within our communities and the harm that can exist for some of our young people who lead more complex lives. So what we have here is the tale of a young male who's in a loving, caring family, but at the age of 10 his behaviour started to change dramatically, and he started to involve himself in violence incidents within the home. This escalated to a point where sadly his parents and carers couldn't cope anymore, and he was placed into foster care at the age of 13. In the months that passed, he'd been stop checked in a number of areas outside of Merseyside with older males, leading to suspicions that he was involved in county lines. And then we reached the back end of last year, where prolonged missing episodes were frequent, and they commenced and were becoming more of a problem. As we reached November, due to the risk that he was putting himself in, he was placed on a full care order. Following this, there were a further 32 missing episodes, with those adding up to 54 days where he was missing. And so, you know, the age of 14, a real, real concern for us. This led us to March, when he was moved into a 90-day crisis placement. Now, sadly, this isn't a unique tale. What I'd like to say here is, I suppose, this is a happy ending. In this, that the male engaged with support services and is now in receipt of mentoring through the provision of the offer that he's getting from social services, amongst others. He's surrounded by positive role models, he's away from those negative influences, and he's responding really positively. So, really good story out of that. I suppose the missing episodes have ceased, involvement in criminality has ceased. Louise, just click one more, please. I suppose another reason for showing this case is to illustrate the costs of such incidents. Now, those numbers at the bottom of the screen relate to the last 4.5 years, so for this individual case, now they are approximate costs and not exact, but they are calculated using a nationally recognised cost-benefit analysis tool. What you see there is some startling figures. You know, the piece costs there nearly £89,000 from one individual due to prolonged missing episodes and involvement in low-level crime and antisocial behaviour. So some quite frightening numbers there. Now, I suppose in terms of the lessons we can learn from this and other cases like it, we can be more effective at identifying young people like Boy A in this case. If we can intervene earlier, if we can work with partners to prevent an escalation to the point where such behaviours as we've seen here are embedded, then we can most importantly prevent children and young people from exposure to such harm. But also we reduce the demands and the costs on numerous agencies, enabling them to invest in more preventative services to divert away from such behaviours. Okay, briefly, this is our draft preventative strategy. It is in draft form at the moment. I appreciate it probably can't be seen on the screen. It articulates our vision, which, if I may read that out, it's working as one team. We will seek to address the underlying causes of crime and vulnerability. By putting our communities first, we will take every opportunity to reduce harm and prevent victimisation whilst building trust and confidence. And, you know, if I can draw your attention to the three key pillars central to our draft strategy there, and they are a focus on children and young people, which is a common theme run right throughout the work that we're doing in preventative policing. So that will see us working in some areas such as seeking to reduce the risk of exploitation, supporting children and young people who are in care, providing effective early intervention. That central pillar is around safeguarding the vulnerable. So this includes reducing violence against women and girls. And you know, this complements some of the outstanding work being done by some of our colleagues within Merseyside Police at the moment in this area. The promotion of healthy relationships and work being done to reduce missing episodes in terms of their duration and frequency. And that third pillar, those issues affecting our communities. So we have consulted communities about what is affecting and worrying them. And you know, in this area, in terms of that third focused pillar, will be around some examples around antisocial behaviour, reducing defending, support and rehabilitation, and other acquisitive crimes such as burglary and robbery. Okay, so this just gives an insight into how we'll deliver on our strategy and our approach. So that first
preventative structure. So this is what we've been working on in recent months, and this seeks to introduce an enhanced model internally, which will build on good practice and success whilst also recognising where we can do more. This will see enhanced functions with additional staff dedicated to preventative work, as well as some new teams being introduced that have a much stronger focus on prevention in order to deliver the Chief Constable's strategy. In terms of the step down from there, that mindset and approach, whilst we're seeking to build on the momentum I spoke about a few minutes ago, we must maintain that focus on the key priorities such as investigation, detection of crime, continuing to tackle serious and organised crime, continuing to build on our engagement with our communities and listening to their feedback, to name just a few. But we will also have a renewed focus upon preventive approaches delivered through dedicated resources whose responsibility it will be to support our wider organisation to embed a renewed approach to early intervention and prevention. Partners, and I've already mentioned this, but to mention again, due to the importance of this in, I suppose, on our preventative journey. You know, we're having some really encouraging dialogue with numerous partners, and we're excited about where we can take this collective objective to work better together and to more effectively prevent crime and the associated harm within our community. There's a real appetite amongst partners across the region, and I'm excited as to where we can take this as a collective. We are seeing prevention feature more heavily across the partnership, including within community safety plans, etc. And so there's a real appetite to make a difference right across us all. I suppose also worthy of mentioning here is the importance of engagement and our relationships with our communities, and recognising that our interactions with all people are what drive trust and confidence in us as a police service. So we're really, really keen to build upon our community engagement strategy, as this will directly support our preventative ambitions. Next slide, please. Yeah, I'll provide a brief overview of some of the good practice going on within our operation interface team and working with teams across the strands. There are numerous examples that clearly could have provided here, but I think this gives us an opportunity to showcase how one of our Home Office grant funded initiatives is making a real difference in our communities. So hotspots policing has been used to really good effect recently in Merseyside. It's a proven method of policing which has been known to be very effective in small defined areas that are experiencing issues with crime. It considers the statistic that suggests approximately 50% of crime occurs in 3% of locations, and seeks to target the said areas to eliminate the harms that are present. Now, Louise knows far more about these, so may jump in, but I'll seek to give an explanation of some of the work that we've been doing here. So the map on the right hand side there shows a larger green zone. This is what's been identified through analysis of data as a high harm, high crime area in Merseyside. Now, the level of harm is mapped against the harm index, which effectively scores every offence recorded based upon its seriousness and volume. And this analysis identified 12 high harm locations, one of which is what we're looking at on the screen. Within these areas, smaller, more defined locations were highlighted and often only contain a few streets or junctions. And once identified, we then seek to deploy staff who are tracked whilst on high visible patrol, or indeed on occasions placed on static locations within these smaller areas. This then allows us to analyse the data coming from this to evaluate the impact of that intervention to establish whether it worked or not, or whether we need to look at our approach in relation to that. Now, Cambridge University have assessed our results, and we're now working with them to identify further hotspots in which we can operate, given that we've seen significant reductions in various crime types within these specific areas, and notably a 26% reduction in serious violence in these areas is something that clearly we want to build upon in terms of that success. And given the successes we've had with this method of deployment, our goal is now to assess and take this learning to see how we can embed this into everyday policing and patrol deployment plans. We've had feedback from Professor Lai Sherman at Cambridge University around the methodology used in Merseyside Police being some of the best in the country. And they've invited us to contribute an article on this piece of work in the Cambridge Journal of Evidence-Based Policing. So, you know, we're really proud of the work that's been done there, and credit to a number of my colleagues within Interface and within our CSD department who've led on this piece of work. Next slide, please. I suppose to finish up for me, you know,
back to why we're doing this. Yes, preventative policing is a force priority, but it's absolutely the right thing to do. The Chief has often spoken about prevention always being better than cure. By this, we seek to prevent crime before it occurs and before it can impact upon a person or a families or indeed communities' lives. And for this reason, whilst we continue to respond to calls for service and continue to investigate serious crime, protect vulnerable people, we will have a much stronger focus on preventing crime before it occurs. Will we get it right every time? Will we stop every crime? Of course, we won't. But I can assure you that we as a collective feel really passionately about this as a way forward. We care about keeping our communities safe and putting our communities first. And as we move on with this enhanced preventative approach, we'll continue to engage with our communities to seek feedback on what works and what doesn't to enable us to evaluate that approach as we move forward. We'll continue to work with partners and communities to learn from our preventative work and seek to build on the learning for the benefit of our communities. And I hope that we'll start to see stronger collaboration with partners, strong relationships with young people, strong relationships in our communities where people feel more confident to call the police, to provide intelligence, to support us in our mission of preventing crime. That concludes my presentation going through this. I hope I've been able to articulate, I suppose, the passion and the enthusiasm that we have within the organisation now to drive our preventative approach forward and work with our communities and partners in order to, I suppose, benefits from this work as we move forward. Thank you.
No, thank you very much. I was really keen that I think we brought on the agenda today because I think it's a really, really important piece of work, and I think it does reflect the kind of the work that's been done to try and empower officers to kind of really problem solve and look maybe beyond what's that initial situation and what can they do in that situation that will stop the crime from happening again. And I think that's a really important message. So I really wanted the public to see that you were thinking about that, because I do think it's a really important conversation to have, and obviously that continuous engagement with communities around how you do that, I think, would be really important. So thank you for that. That was really a really good piece of work. We did have a couple of questions from the public who were quite keen on this area as well, one of which we have spoken about in previous meetings, and we did touch on it a little bit in terms of young people perpetrating low-level crime, and we know that can escalate, and what are your strategies to combat this? So obviously I know that we have the Vice Structure Partnership, and there's a lot of work being done there. Is there anything more you want to add in terms of your approach, particularly around young people and the prevention space?
I think probably the draft strategy showed there that children and young people will be absolutely central to what we're doing in relation to our preventative work there. So by working with partners, we'll seek to identify and intervene earlier in terms of children on the brink of criminality. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, there's some really good examples out there in terms of the Violence Reduction Partnership, Operation Stonehaven, and other examples within the organisation where we're doing some really good work about that early intervention, working with some key partners, key delivery partners who are, you know, youth workers and a variety of other people within the county who are doing some excellent work to draw people away from the grip of criminality.
Good, yeah, and I think that the follow-up question from that is
I was just going to ask that, Commissioner, is you know, the question from the public around young people engaging in low levels of crime, mm-hmm. if they then become, they tip into that offender, then got the work through John's criminal justice portfolio around deferred prosecutions, and again specifically aimed at 18 to 25 year olds and keeping them out of the criminal justice system through a education and rehabilitative programme.
Great. So it's at every point as they go through the journey that we're looking for opportunities to try and get them out of the criminal system, which I think is really welcome. So the other question then, which I think links on to the young people, but looks particularly at deprived areas, and I think maybe you've picked up on that in terms of the patterns of the hotspot policing you touched upon. So are you looking at things around deprived areas and how you work with partners to tackle things around wellbeing, educational achievement, and some of those kind of fringe issues that we know can play a key role in terms of offending?
Yeah, I think there's a number of pieces of ongoing work in relation to that. Again, you know, links into some of the work that we're doing with our partners. You know, a lot of what we're doing here, we're operating in areas where we have the greatest demand, which is often in those deprived areas. So through our analysis and, you know, what we learn from there, we will ensure that our interventions are where we need them most.
Great, thank you. Chief Constable, I see Roy, do you want to add anything?
All I would say to that is, you know, in addition to Andy's comments, if you look at the statistics,
time today, we appreciate it.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Off now, so thank you for that. Okay, right, so if we go back there to, we've got key areas of focus today, custody and also mental health, so I think we're going to start with custody. Louise.
So Commissioner, this slide is showing the arrest nail of somebody between the April 21 to March 22. At force level, violence is consistently our largest arrest reason, followed by most being in drugs offences. Overall, those three together account for 50% of all the arrests in the last 3 years. We have a drug flag, which is basically when we tick to say drugs is an element of this arrest, and that accounts for around 25% of arrests. Most of those are primary drug offences, but also motoring accounts for quite a significant proportion of those. I'm going to come on to ALOP in further slides, so we'll go to the ALOP on this one. But the arrests, you can see there, a fairly static trend. You see that increase in arrests in March. We've had a little look at that, you know, and we see that some of those as positives, but also the arrest reasons have remained static, so violence offences, motoring and drugs as well. And then on the right-hand side there, you can see the age category and how that's you know, what proportions are across the 3 years. So the top one, the age category 10 to 16, for example, in 2019 there was 2% of the arrests with people aged 10 to 16. This year it is 3%, but you can see the volume is significantly different because the percentage is the proportion of the total. If you look at the difference, you've got 1,253 16-year-olds in 2019, but in 2021, 787. So it just, you can see the shift really is in that age bracket over 55 and 46 and 55 across the 3 years when you compare to 2019 to 2021.
Okay, so I'm sorry, I'm struggling with some data. So it's all because the years have grown. So the number of arrests across the board have reduced the last 3 years?
Yes, so the arrest total 2019-20 was 27,955. And then we need this most current year 25,343 from a statistical point of view, so it's fairly static with last year.
Okay.
But I think also we've had, you know, pandemic, but there's lots of variables within that which would mean that.
So I was going to ask then, should we know why there has been a drop? Is it COVID related or is it more about, as John Warren was saying, about the kind of John Warren?
Yeah, just a couple of Louise's commentary there. We do know our arrests fall nationally up to 10-12%. We're in line with the national trend in the years leading up to COVID. Clearly, COVID's had a more significant impact. When you look at some of the things we were talking about previously around keeping children out of custody, it's now pretty rare for children to be arrested and taken into custody now, which impacts the overall arrest numbers. But the other things that impact on the use of out-of-court disposals, such as community resolutions, again, trying to keep people out of custody, not to negatively impact their life chances, for low-level, what we describe as low-level offending. But that said, we have done a significant amount of work recently using focus groups with our staff to understand where they sit around their own proactivity, and those things that they consider that we might do different to just ease the path, really, when arrested. So we're really conscious of that, supporting our staff to make life as easy for them as possible, whilst also really focusing on our preventative agenda that Andy described so well earlier on, and focusing on keeping people out of the criminal justice system the best way ever in the first place.
And sorry, did you say then that some of the key offence types were around violent offences, and that that's the majority of people who are being arrested is when it's a violent offence?
Yes, violence, principally offences.
Right, okay, great, thank you. And is that the same for adults and youth?
Yeah, well, I have got for youth specific,
okay.
In totality, that's, and it does normally stay for a while,
okay.
With the exception of both of them.
Okay, yeah, okay, fair enough. Okay, and we're going to come on to ALOP a bit later on, so is there anything else in this one? Okay,
arrest have fallen by the time they come to custody, the whole situation's calmed down and therefore it serves no purpose to keep to further their detention. When we have a little look, we track this through our use of PACE and APP, etc. And when you look at the total arrests, less than 1% have a detention not authorised. This is also scrutinised by independent custody visitors.
So what we're saying is the vast majority of arrests were made and the decision was made that it was the right thing to do as opposed to later deciding it shouldn't.
Yeah, it's not that it's the wrong decision. So the custody sergeant has to make a decision based on the necessity criteria for arrest, the set necessity criteria that justifies, and the custody sergeants are the arbiter and the guardian of that. I think we'll probably be a bit worried if 100% of people who were arrested met those criteria at the point of being booked in and assessed by the custody sergeant. As we can see there, fewer than 1% of people arrested under detention, not authorised. That's for many of the reasons as Louise described. We monitor it on a daily basis and then we assess it through our performance management. So a lot of lessons learned, worked on that, but the vast majority of those arrests are lawful arrests and go on to be, the investigation process is furthered another way, usually through voluntary attendance.
Okay, great. Any questions you can ask? Okay.
This is really just for information, the arrest profile. So 84.45% of our arrests are males, 15.5% female, and 0.05% other, just 14 there. That other will also include undisclosed gender. So you can see from the trend in 2021, the reason why you can't see figures within those percentages is that they're static across the year, the 2 years, the proportions. And then on the right-hand side there, you can see a full breakdown of self-defined ethnicity categories, comparing 2019-20 to 2021-22, and with the volumes associated to them there. So you can see that. 82.74 in the most recent figures on here, and then 84.37. Sometimes one of the percentage points are slightly different as we move to the nearest decimal point.
Right.
Yeah. So that's really just for information.
Do we know how that reflects the broader population in terms of disproportionality or anything?
So on this next slide, so the rate per 1,000 population for this year, 17.6 for arrest rate per 1,000 population. So that's the total population, 17.6 people are arrested as of that over the year. When you then look across the categories, those who self-define within the aggregated group of black or other, they show disproportionality compared to the force average.
Okay.
So for example, the force average is 1 times lightly. And then the for the black or other ethnicities, it's saying 2.3 times more likely to be arrested. The direction of travel with this though is definitely a positive one. We see that in 2019, that group of black or other was 2.7 times more likely to be arrested. And then, as I've just said there, this year, 2.3 times more likely to be arrested.
And do we have any understanding as to why that might be the case, or are there any particular crime types, or is there anything being done to look at how we can keep reducing that?
So, in terms of, obviously, that's part of the National Race Action Plan around improving policing for black communities, that's specifically around black communities. That work is being led by Jenny Sims, but also more broadly around disproportionality as well. That's being picked up in the inclusion strategy, which again is being led by people services. So whilst it's a people services piece of work, it's four superintendents picking up each of the key pillars of work that are in the National Race Action Plan, and then looking at our broader action plan as well.
Great, thank you.
Any questions?
Okay, thanks. This one is around adult vulnerability in the appropriate adult service specifically. So between April 2021 and March 2022, you can see
the figures there, particularly to the left-hand side. The average response time is 28 minutes this financial year, but when you then look at 28 minutes, sorry, and then if you look back to 2016-17, it was 35 minutes, and over the years it has fluctuated. The average call length at the moment is 2.24 hours, and I would say that, again, fairly static, and probably at the peak in May 24, 2017-18. The total cost per call out is actually the lowest it's ever been. It's currently at £89.07. The highest it's ever been is £110.43. And then the number of call outs, 1,401 compared to 725 in the year 2016-17. So obviously it's the responsibility of the local authority to provide that appropriate adult for juveniles, or for the juvenile to be represented by their own appropriate adult. And then in the case of no appropriate adult, it goes to the appropriate adult service to support that, which is authorised by the custody inspector.
Can I just ask about that? Do we know why it's been an increase in the number of appropriate adults needed? Is it officers getting better at spotting vulnerability, or are we seeing more vulnerable people coming through the system?
I'll take that, Commissioner. The both, really. So there's a lot of effort and training gone into recognising and managing vulnerability in the custody environment. That's come out of place more on around constant observations of the use of that. I won't stray into that territory now, it's all interconnected. But then also reflects the fact that more and more officers and staff are having to deal with people in crisis and points of contact, whether that be mental health or other aspects of vulnerability. More and more, that is what our officers and staff have to deal with in the public domain, and it's reflected in those people who are brought into custody and the vulnerability of some of them, the complexity of their needs in custody. What is really good about that, I think, whereas it's not good that we have that, what is good is that piece around recognising it, dealing with it, the cost is coming down, and more importantly, the time taken to get appropriate adults out to support the most vulnerable at their time of need is reducing too. So, really significant impact on policing in Merseyside.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, thank you for that.
This is the airlock features over 60 minutes. What I didn't say on the earlier slide was around the average airlock, which is currently 23.
Can you just clarify what you think airlock, what that means?
So the airlock is the custody suite. What amendment are you?
It's when you arrive at the custody suite, when a prisoner arrives at the custody suite, they don't, before their detention is authorised by a custody sergeant, we have to be sure that there is a clear and safe environment for them to be booked in. So until a custody sergeant is free and available to do that, they will remain in a holding area, which is what we refer to as the airlock. So what this does is it gives you an idea of the average time that it takes from the point of arrival at a custody suite to a point where a custody sergeant has assessed the necessity of their arrest, agreed it, and then starts to manage the any risk factors associated with that individual, so their vulnerability, mental health needs, drugs and alcohol, and so on and so forth. The time that you see there includes the time it takes for an officer to relate the circumstances of